Today I am going to be looking at the PowerMac G4 Cube, one of Apple's most beautiful failures. But to find out why it failed and what's wrong with this one, you see it's working, well, you're just going to have to watch. So my name is JSB, this is my tech department. Los geht's! The PowerMac G4 is beautiful. There's no denying that. Introduced in 2000 by Steve Jobs, the Cube was a game changer. It looked like it was floating, with the machine suspended inside a small 20cm by 20cm case. Jobs wanted a simple machine without the fuss of the larger PowerMac range. The Cube was the solution. Designed by Johnny Ive and his team, this was a machine for the designers, not the engineers. It was also heavily compromised. The internals had no fan to help with cooling, the supplied hard disks were slow, and the 64MB of memory tiny compared to the larger G4 PowerMacs. Reaching the internals though was simple. Just flip the machine upside down, push the handle on the base, and lift it out. Inside you'd find three RAM slots, a single 3.5-inch hard drive mount, and a thin slot-loading DVD drive. It's the DVD drive that's causing us issues today. Now these drives are notorious for failing, losing the ability to take in and remove discs once you're done with them. So let's see if we can service the drive and get it back up in working order. So let's start by getting the computer out of the case. And to do that, I'm making use of the tech department pillow because I don't want to scratch the plastic casing. Lift the handle and we're out, and then I can put the casing out of the way and we can now get access to the full thing. To get access to the drive, we need to flip the machine back on its back, and we'll need to start with a T10 screwdriver Torx bit and get that top off. There are four screws on the top and they all take the T10. So it's nice and simple, remove these four screws, and then we'll head to the next four. With four screws at the top, there are just four screws hidden around the side, two on one side, two on the other. Now these can be a little tight, and please note that there is a longer screw and a shorter screw, with the longer screw being in the center. With those removed, you are then free to remove the top of the case, but you have to be careful. Underneath this plate is the power button and the little circuit board with it. You have to pry away the connector, and you have to be really careful when lifting that top piece up so it doesn't break. With the connector away, you can move it. With the top now removed, we just need to remove these two little sidebars, and they can be a little stiff, but they'll come away easily enough with a little persuasion. Finally, we need to remove this front cover. Now, this can be in there pretty tight, and as you can see, I'm kind of struggling to get it out, but it does actually come up in the end, revealing our DVD drive. Now there are four screws retaining the DVD drive. To help, we can move the airport card slot here out of the way, and you can see there are two screw holes there, and there are two further screw holes on the other side. Again, it's our 10 Torx 10 bit, and yeah, just take these out and then flip it around and do the same on the other side. On the other side, the screws are a lot more easy to get hold of, and yeah, once these are out, the drive just lifts up. With the drive loose now, we can lift it away, and that gives us access to be able to unplug the IDE cable and the power cable. Now that comes towards you, not down, so just be aware of that. And with that out, our DVD is free and easy. With the DVD now free, we have to remove the card on the back that connects the power and IDE connectors to this tiny little drive. You'll need a small Phillips head screwdriver and apparently a view of my wedding ring. Still, some things are never easy to film, that's for sure. Nonetheless, it's undo two screws and they're very tiny, so make sure you keep an eye on these, and then the card just pulls away. The final screws to be undone, there's two tiny little screws on either side of the case, so just carefully undo one and the other, and then you can lift it away and it should just open. So with the drive uncovered, let's take a quick look, and generally it's actually pretty clean in here. At the top you'll see the levers that when you put a disc in, they open, activating the sensor which tells it to draw the disc in. There's a little roller underneath there, we're going to have to clean that. At the back, well, there's signs of dust and you can see where there's scratching on the metal, so we'll put a little silicone grease on there to help. Turning to our drive belt, well, that's not in great condition. It's pretty much stretched out to its limit. It's dry, and although it is turning that wheel, it's very easy for it to slip. Now, the distance between there and there is actually 100 millimeters, and this drive belt is 100 millimeters. It's stretched out. You can see where it's even kinked at the ends. There's no more stretch in it, so what do we do next? Well, we take our drive belt and we stretch it out and we measure it, and that is 100 millimeters across, more or less. Now, the drive to replace it, we need a drive belt half that size. So we want a 49 or 50 millimeter drive belt. With the drive belt off, I can also now take the chance to clean the roller. You do that by removing two little springs and then lift that little black plastic piece off. And as you can see, our roller is covered in dirt and dust, which is not good for it. It actually needs to be cleaned because it's quite sticky. And that's a good thing. It's not often you can say that about things, but it's a good thing. So I take some isopropyl alcohol and give it a clean. And look, you can already see the dirt coming off it. It's not in great condition. Let's speed this up and carry on, and you can see how much dirt comes off this roller. As with everything, this is a job that's going to take time. And even sped up, this took a good 5 to 10 minutes of my day, just gently cleaning and removing that grime and filth until the roller came clean, essentially. Eventually, you can see that it's looking nice and, you know, kind of sticky, which is, again, what we want. And so we can then move on to looking at our replacement belt. While we wait to finish cleaning, let's get a word from our sponsor, PCBWay. We all know that PCBWay make fantastic PCB boards, starting from just $5, and include things like, well, getting a replacement board for this old ZX Spectrum. What happens if your 3D printer isn't up to the task? Or you're having a little trouble with your CNC machine? Then look no further than PCBWay. In fact, if you can design it, PCBWay can help make it a reality. PCBWay, way more than just PCBs. For more information, check out the link in the description below. With the roller clean and looking pretty good, actually, I must say, it's time to replace that little black item on top. Now, there are two slots where it fits into. You can see there that there are then single springs on the side. It's not quite fitting, so you pull that out and that little plastic piece slots inside. Then it's a matter of just reattaching two tiny little springs. You can see one there as I reframe. That was subtle, and that's how that's done. Meanwhile, our new belt is here, and this is an actual 49 millimeter belt. You can see how much smaller it is, so that's how much our belt has stretched. Replacing it is, I mean, it's not difficult. I'm just making it look difficult. But yeah, it's simply a matter of just hooking it on the belt drive there and away to go. With that sorted and our springs reconnected for our black piece at the front, let's reassemble it and get it back in the computer. Okay, so the cube is back together and yeah, let's see if we actually had some success. I'm not sure. It went in, That's good. And it came out. It sticks, but that might need adjustment in the queue case, but let's try it again. Interesting. It's decided it doesn't want that to skip. Let's see what happened. Okay, people, after about an hour and a half of screwing around and taking drives apart, shouting at it, crying in the corner, you know, the usual thing when working on these drives, I think we've made progress. Now, I'm going to be brave. This is a game for OS 9. Let's see. In. Is it going to spin up and tell us it's there? Yes. Yes, it's reading. There we go. So the disk is there. And now I'm going to eject it. Fingers crossed. It works. It works. Oh, that's a relief. I hate these drives.
Well, there we have it. The Mac Cube is back together. And well, that actually turned out to be a bit more of a saga than I was expecting. It seems when after filming I went to put this machine back together, it threw a tantrum. I'm not sure what exactly the problem was, but I suspect I had put the memory modules, although they've been with the machine for 20 years, I'd put them in different slots, and the machine was unhappy, so it wouldn't work. Still, after an hour of fault finding, I got it back up and running. And now to confirm, here's our Tesco CDR, which this machine doesn't like. In it goes, perfect. And in a minute, that'll spit it back out. What's next for this cube? Well, I really need to strip it down. Oh, thank you. Good job. See, it works. I really need to strip this machine down because I want to get that processor out of there. Because, well, this machine suffers from overheating. And that processor was installed 24 years ago. The thermal paste is probably more than crunchy, so a fresh coat of thermal paste will do this machine wonders and hopefully keep it running for another 24 years. I'd also like to upgrade this machine to a full gig and a half memory and change out that hard drive for something a little swifter, a SATA SSD no doubt. Other than that, I'm happy with it as it is. I don't really plan to make any changes to the machine. I don't want to push it any harder because it's just great as it is. Now then, at the start of the video, I did say this was one of Apple's most beautiful failures. What did I mean? Well, the machine came with problems, the biggest of which, it's not upgradable. Whilst there were two spare memory slots on this machine when it was new, there's only room for one hard drive. The graphics card is pretty much fixed in this machine. There are very few, if any, graphics cards out there that can fit. And what you see is what you get. But what really finished this machine off was the price. Debuting in 2000, this machine would have cost you $1,799. Now that's a lot of money for a machine that looks gorgeous and, you know, maybe it's worth it. But if you wanted something a bit more upgradable, you could get the PowerMac G4. Now, I have a number of those here. You're looking at one on screen right now. And although this machine only came with a 400 megahertz processor, it was vastly more upgradable than this. You had room to insert various input-output add-on cards. There was room to change out that GPU if you wanted something more powerful. It could take four hard drives in the case. And it was just generally a much better machine. It was also $200 cheaper. Selling at just $1,599, the PowerMac G4 was, well, it killed the poor cube here. Even when they reduced this down to $1,299, it was very difficult to make sales. And in the end, whilst the iMac G3, for example, made over 5 million models available to the public, this sold just 150,000. By Apple standards, this was a failure. But the lessons learnt on the Cube didn't go to waste. A few years later, the cube would kind of reemerge as the Mac Mini. A much smaller form factor, again the same idea, running at a whopping 1.42 gigahertz, mind you, I have one right here, you're probably looking at it on screen right now. And yeah, that was sold for just $599. A bargain. So all that's left to say now is, thank you so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed the video. I enjoyed making it, even if this did give me a little bit of grief. And yeah, down below you'll find the usual socials and things. And all that's left to say is, when it comes to old computers like this cube, just because it didn't sell a lot, doesn't mean it's not worth your time. Remember, reuse, rediscover, and if you're lucky, you might find your own G4 cube that's just waiting for love, care, and attention. Cheers!